The role of air traffic control in aviation in the modern day is essential. Controllers, whether they are located at an airport or remotely, have a real-time, live bird's-eye view of their airspace. Airspace, as you might expect, is packed with planes of all sizes surrounding larger airports. Assuming that airspace is arranged appropriately, and the controllers and pilots are fully aware and follow the rules, there is nothing unsafe here. The prospect of a mid-air collision, though, can be extremely terrifying, especially for those already predisposed with a fear of flying. To overcome these fears, education is always an interesting jumping-off point. Once one gains a greater understanding of something that can appear intimidating, they may be far more inclined to face that fear. I say that because aviation is complex. It can be a lot to take in. So for this video, I'd like to take a moment to look deeper at a lesser-known mid-air collision, that of which occurred in the skies above Salt Lake City, Utah in 1987. We'll learn about the itineraries of the planes involved, the events which transpired for these two planes to end up at the same point in the sky at the same time, and how technologies have developed to prevent such tragedies from happening again. The date was January 15th, 1987. SkyWest Flight 1834 was making a trip between Pocatello, Idaho and Salt Lake City. The plane was a small Fairchild Metroliner commuter plane. The aircraft left Pocatello at 12:16 p.m. Mountain Time for the 250-kilometer flight. On board were just 6 passengers and 2 pilots. Seated on the flight deck was 37-year-old Captain Michael Gamble. Sat next to him was his first officer, 33-year-old Walter Ray. The two pilots were based out of Salt Lake City, and so knew the area and its airspace well. On this occasion, the active runways at Salt Lake City were landing and departing from the south. Flight 1834, approaching the airport from the north, was cleared onto a downwind approach to fly past the airport. Once they were several miles south of the airport, the pilots would then be given instructions to line up for landing onto runway 34 left. It should be noted that runway 34 left in 1987 was different to the 34 left that exists today. In their descent, the pilots of Flight 1834 were passed from one controller to another before being handed off to their final approach controller at 12:47. It was only a short flight, being that this occurred just 30 minutes after they had taken off. This final controller cleared the small Metroliner to descend further. In this case, the altitude of 7,000 feet was given. It should also be noted that Salt Lake City sits at an elevation greater than 4,000 feet, so the plane was roughly actually around 3,000 feet above the ground. It clearly was a busy day for air travel at Salt Lake City, as the controller also issued Flight 1834 with a traffic advisory of a nearby Boeing 737 aircraft. Flight 1834 replied acknowledging the lookout instruction. They, however, would never spot this plane, or at least according to the ATC transcript. Knowing that this incident was a mid-air collision, this was not the other plane involved. To discuss that, we need to refocus our analysis on a different airport that sits just under 20 kilometers south of Salt Lake City's main airport. Here we'll find South Valley Regional Airport, located in the Kearns area of town. This is a small general aviation airport that was formerly a World War II airfield. Since then, the airport has been frequented by private pilots and flight school operators. On the day of January 15, 1987, a small Mooney M20 left this airport with 2 occupants at 11:30 a.m., before the SkyWest plane had even left Pocatello. The two people in question were described to be experienced private pilots by the names of Chester Baker, who owned the plane and sat in the left seat, and Paul Lietz, who was an instructor. The two men were pretty good friends and flew together occasionally. It is believed that Baker was undergoing necessary instrument flight training, and that was the purpose of this flight. The Mooney brand of private general aviation airplanes are very popular among private pilots. Over 11,000 M20s have been built over the decades. With just one piston-powered engine, the the four-seater plane had become one of the most common single-engine planes in the skies. On this occasion, this Mooney plane had performed multiple touch-and-go circuit operations and happened to be the only plane in that airport's traffic pattern. According to the accident report, the investigation interviewed pilots who had flown with the instructor, which revealed he had substantial knowledge of the airspace in this area and even encouraged a flight pattern that would make a sharp right turn immediately after taking off from the north-facing runway to avoid any conflict with airspace belonging to Salt Lake City's main international airport. After around an hour after first taking off at around 12:30, recorded radar data showed that the pilots then traveled 25 miles southeast before turning again, heading in a northwesterly direction, and had begun climbing, and would continue to climb until it reached 7,000 feet. This data would also seem to indicate that the private Mooney plane flew into the airspace around Salt Lake City Airport. The last contact the plane had with an air traffic controller was with a Unicom controller at 11:50 a.m. That controller also mentioned that that conversation was in relation to the Mooney's touch-and-go operations before they journeyed off elsewhere. She also mentioned that she did not see the plane depart following this touch-and-go. There were no further communications relating to the traffic pattern between the Unicom controller and the Mooney. Back in the tower at Salt Lake City, a controller who was monitoring the airspace and conversing with SkyWest 1834 noticed a radar blip that appeared to be flying in a north-northwesterly heading, which would appear from the radar data to be the Mooney plane, as it was now in their airspace. To quote the accident report, he said, the controller, he had no more than normal cause to monitor the target. He also stated that it was not unusual to observe VFR targets in the pattern near SLC-2 during visual meteorological conditions. VFR stands for Visual Flight Rules. It's a set of rules for pilots flying in fair weather with good visibility. It requires pilots to follow a see-and-avoid strategy to avoid any kind of conflict with other aircraft. Pilots flying VFR assume this responsibility on top of not intruding on a category of airspace they cannot enter without permission. Likewise, the pilots of the SkyWest Metroliner must also follow a philosophy of see and be seen. The airspace around Salt Lake City had what was called an Airport Radar Service Area, shortened to ARSA. It's a three-dimensional area that not only covers areas laterally, but also vertically, with the base of this airspace being around 5,400 feet and extending upwards of 8,000 feet. Without permission to enter, general aviation aircraft under visual flight rules would generally have to avoid this airspace. The Mooney pilots, having no conversations with the controllers who controlled this airspace, also needed to stay away. However, the small plane still entered that airspace. The accident report notes that the intrusion, having considered all options, was not intentional, and that pilot incapacitation was ruled out. Instead, this was largely put down to pilot error on behalf of the instructor pilot. As you may have noticed, the flight path of the Mooney had taken them rather close in proximity to SkyWest 1834. The SkyWest Metroliner then began a turn to their left as normal, having passed the airport by several miles for a turn onto final for the runway. By happenstance, in an unfortunately fatal coincidence, the Mooney also turned to their left. The coincidental turns put the two planes on a collision course. The Mooney lacked the transponder capabilities to transmit altitude information to the ground, meaning controllers could not determine the Mooney's altitude themselves, which was, by the time of the inevitable collision, 7,000 feet, the same as SkyWest 1834. The modern TCAS systems had not yet been introduced, meaning the pilots would have to look out for each other themselves, see and be seen. It would be reasonable to assume that the pilots of the SkyWest plane were caught up in preparations for their landing. The investigation, though, would later state in their report that this does not absolve them of their responsibility to look out for potentially conflicting traffic. We don't know what was going on in the Mooney. In the final seconds before disaster, it is noted in the accident report, the pilots of the SkyWest plane saw the Mooney and attempted an evasive maneuver. According to the ATC transcript, for a moment over the radio, SkyWest 1834 transmitted an expletive. They, unfortunately, were unable to avoid the collision. The two planes collided at 7,000 feet at 12:52 in the afternoon. The Metroliner crashed onto a suburban road on West 5255 Street. Other wreckage was spread out over an area of 1 square mile in the Kearns area of Salt Lake City. 10 people were killed in the disaster, everyone on both planes. No one on the ground was hurt, though there was some damage to some homes and a nearby school, which lays less than 200 meters away from the crash site. So, what has been done since this disaster to prevent midair collisions like this from occurring again? Perhaps you may have noted, if you are a regular viewer of the channel, that this accident bears a striking resemblance to that of the PSA Flight 182 disaster, which occurred in San Diego in 1978. A shockingly similar incident also transpired in Los Angeles just 1 year before the Salt Lake City disaster. Another small private plane collided with Aeromexico Flight 498. The smaller plane collided with the DC-9 on the tail fin, which soon crashed in the Cerritos suburb of Los Angeles, leading to 82 total fatalities, including over a dozen on the ground. As swiftly mentioned earlier in this video, TCAS had not yet been introduced in the 1980s. The Traffic Collision Avoidance System would, over the following decade, become standard on all modern airplanes. Further developments in radar technologies have also given clearer clarity to air traffic controllers. Even despite these advancements in technology, however, a series of fatal midair collisions still occurred through the 1990s and 2000s decades, including a near-collision incident in 2001, which would have been the deadliest aviation disaster to have ever occurred, with nearly 700 lives lost, if it wasn't for the swift evasive actions made by one of the pilots. The events and causes in those disasters vary. For more information on all these incidents, we already have videos on them, and they can now be found in a dedicated playlist to midair collisions. Hello, and a big thank you for watching. I will keep this outro short, as it's that time of the week where I take a moment to thank my patrons over on Patreon for their generous support. We have now hit 100 patrons on the Patreon, which is incredible. I never anticipated this many people would join, so it's at this time that we may need to soon reevaluate the shoutout benefits, as this list is getting rather long. We'll soon need to keep it to just the new patrons. But thank you all so much for the support on the Patreon campaign over this last year. I am truly grateful. Thanks. But anyway, a thank you to the £5 tier patrons Adventures is Stupid, Alice Lutris, Avery Teoda, Barlavon, Chill Helm, Hunter Heilman, Hector Parmateles, Jennifer Verketic, Joey, John Ambrosia, KTP123, Kelly Randoya, Ken Zachman, Kenneth Morins, Len, Leon St. Jennings, Lizzie Wizzy Let's Get Busy, Marie Innes, MG, Michelle, Mom Left Me a Best Buy, MX Koifish, Pac-Man 7, Panic Chicken, Pedro Cruz, Rebecca Rivers, Rez, Rio Wheatley, Saria Melody, Sir Waffleton, Sleepy, Tristan Kriegsman, and Tyrwin. I hope I said that right. And a special thanks to the very generous £10 tier patrons, Aidan Montgomery, Ansid, David Dabrowski, Derek Bean, Epsilon, Evgeny Chernov, Karma, Maga Seal, Mike Milton, Roger Mayer, So FP, Steve Cottrell, Thick Coconut, Trans Rights Baby, Vapronva, and Where Are My Cheetos? And that is it from me this week. I hope you have a good weekend, and I will see you next week. Goodbye.